Live from Studio 1A, I'm Jody Denberg on KUT 90.5, and with me, two of the greatest songwriters in America, John Hiatt and Lyle Lovett. Good afternoon, gentlemen.
Afternoon, Jody.
Hey, Jody. Good to see you.
And you guys are going to be at the Paramount Theater tonight and tomorrow night. And from what I understand, the month of June has just been a kickback, take it easy kind of thing. No, actually, you've been doing shows just about every night, right?
Well, you know, we have been, but we like that.
We like rigor.
Well, you know, we've gotten to play some of the just really greatest theaters in the, you know, western part of the country, and some great outdoor venues, and really had a wonderful time.
Beautiful. We prefer rigor to rigor mortis.
Well said, John. Well said. John and I started working together. The first time we sat on stage together was in October of 1989, along with Guy Clark and Joe Ely, and so we've known each other since then, and have been doing this every now and then, you know, ever since then.
A long time.
Yeah.
The last time you were at the Paramount was with Guy and Joe. I guess too many Texans for you, John. It was too much.
No, you know, it's great to have that many Texans around, because you know you don't have to say a word.
You know? Well, thank you, John.
Plenty of talking.
Thank
there,
you. So. Well, take that as a compliment.
Now, I know you've been playing together on and off since 1989, but can either of you actually remember when you first met?
I remember when I first, I remember when I first saw John Hiatt. It was the 31st of January, 1981, at the Paramount Theater. John and his entire band were Ry Cooder's band for Ry Cooder's Borderline album tour. Yeah. Uncle Walt's band opened the show, it was when Uncle Walt's band was using those old RCA style microphones and gathering around the one microphone stand. It was just incredible.
Oh, so
they
great.
Were incredible that night. Their closing number for the set was Stagger Lee, and it just got the house rocking. And then came out Ry Cooder with John Hiatt, with Bobby King, and Willie Green Jr.
Yeah.
And I watched that show and I thought, oh my goodness. I had all the Ry Cooder records I could find. And in College Station, and which wasn't easy to do, but I was unfamiliar with John. But by the end of that night, I was really familiar with him. Ry Cooder gave John a solo on almost every song.
It was his sense of humor.
And now I'm realizing that vocal blend informs the large band.
Thank you. That's a nice way to say that. Yeah. No, I watched that and thought, wow. Now I want to do that. I watched that show. Yeah.
John, do you remember the first time you met or saw Lyle?
Man, I don't. You know, I don't have the kind of memory that Lyle has, for one thing. The guy's got a steel trap mind, you know. But I'm thinking it was in the mid '80s sometime. I think we were introduced by Ken.
Ken actually played one of the first times I Ken Levitan,
who manages both
of us, I met in 1984 on one of my first trips to Nashville, and he was an attorney in those days. In 1985, we started working together, but he had that blue sob, and the first time I rode in that blue sob, he said, you ever hear John Hiatt? And I said, well, yeah, he plays with Ry Cooder, right? He said, well, here's one of his records, so.
Yeah, but I met you in Nashville, I think, through Ken.
1986, we did a fundraiser for Roseanne Cash at the Belcourt Theater, movie theater.
That was it.
You played Memphis in the meantime.
That's right.
And we got to speak.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. There you go. And see, he remembers better than
you,
I do.
You stood up and played, unlike we're doing now. You stood up and played, and I like the way you shuffled your feet.
Everything's so tightly scripted here, I need to just keep it on target.
Oh, okay, Jody.
I mean, this is fun. You guys really like each other and have a good...
Yeah, we do. We get along pretty well. We have a good time on stage.
We really do have a good time on stage because, you know, John is just, he's really gracious to me on stage. And we first started out, we were hosted by Bill Ivey from the Country Music Foundation, went on later to chair the National Endowment for the Arts. Bill Ivey invited Guy Clark and Joe Ely and John and me to do a series of shows across the country. Bill would stay on stage with us and kind of moderate and asked us questions and poke at us a little bit.
It was a little odd, wasn't it?
It was a little odd. But now, so
bless his heart.
Bless his heart. Yeah. The we 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 So now I get to ask John questions. And you know, John never plays the same set two nights in a row. And so, you know, he always inspires different questions. And I really enjoy getting to talk to him. And I try to put myself in the position of somebody in the audience and you know, ask questions that somebody at the show might want to know the answer to.
You know, it's really turned out to Lyle's more like my therapist. This is how it's really been going. It's like I'm on the couch every night.
Well, and as someone who has seen you both play in a variety of situations, this is so unique. And John, I'm going to throw it to you for a song, and I'm just curious what in the world you're going to play, because there's no list in front of you.
No. Well, you know, I got a new record coming out, so I thought I'd play a new one.
You know, I've heard that record, and it's great. It comes out.
Thanks, Joe.
I know it's August 2nd because it's my birthday, but "Dirty Jeans and Mudslide Hymns" is the name of this record. Lyle, have you heard it yet? The album.
I've heard some of the songs, but this is a revelation to me. You've actually heard the record, and I was under the impression that maybe some of the song choices were still up in the air, based on, I don't know, maybe something you said.
Well, they were, but they got gathered up and sent out.
Very recently,
yeah,
I tell you.
Yeah. Things happen so fast in show business.
Since last night. Oh, my God.
I do not have any artwork. I do not have anything like that. I just have a CD with some
songs.
You've
heard the record?
Yeah. As a matter of fact, Lyle, hold on. Here you go, partner.
I'll tell you, the songs.
Toss that one over to you. No disrespect to the disc, of course, but I just wanted to toss that to you so you could have one as well.
Hey, that's going to be the name of my next record. No disrespect to the disc,
no
of course.
No disrespect.
And no disrespect to John Hiatt or Lyle Lovett either. We're just having some fun, but we're going to make some music live on KUT 90.5.
They killed my brother in a poker game. Damn this town, I'm leaving. Daddy stayed drunk and he died insane. Damn this town, I'm leaving. Mama had to work, couldn't raise the kids. Damn this town, I'm leaving. I don't wanna tell you what her youngest boy did. Damn this town, I'm leaving. Damn this town, I mean it this time. Damn this town, I made up my mind. Life. about my family. Damn this town, I'm leaving. But maybe you'd like to know a little about me. Damn this town, I'm leaving. I'm 58 years old, still living. Mama, tell you what her youngest boy did. Damn this town, I'm leaving.
John Hiatt, thank you, sir.
You're welcome, sir.
KUT 90.5, a live take on Damn This Town. That's going to be on John's next record, Dirty Jeans and Mudslide Hymns. John Hiatt and Lyle Lovett, who's also with us, will be at the Paramount Theater tonight and tomorrow night. Lyle, didn't you like that last chord? That was a kind of interesting sound to me.
You know, I liked all the chords.
All three of them?
Especially the last one, yes. But,
John, I want to ask you a question, and I know you always shoot me straight. You've done about in the neighborhood of 20 records since 1974. I heard this record before I came in. I told you I really liked it, and I meant that sincerely.
Thank you.
I'm sure over the years there's records that you like more or less, or in hindsight you go, you know, that was a really good one, and that was not my best.
Yeah.
When you're putting out a record, though, do you always feel like this one's right?
Well, sure you do. Of course, you know, half the time you're fooling yourself, probably, but I always feel like, well, this is a good one. But, you know. It takes a while to get some perspective, I think, but
this is a good one.
Well, I'm pretty proud of it. I'm happy the work that the people involved did. Enjoyed working with the producer Kevin Shirley, and I think the band played really great. And you know, I think we just had a something sort of a little bit of magic happen. So that's all you can hope for, you know, making a record. So hopefully it'll hold up.
There's a lot of titles I could give each of you, band leaders, guitarists, but to me, you're both songwriters. Lyle, was there a moment when you decided, that's what I want to do, I want to write songs, as opposed to I want to be the guy out front, or I want to be the electric guitarist, or the drummer, or the lead vocalist kind of thing? Was there a moment where you thought, I want to write the songs?
You know, there's never been a moment of enlightenment for me at all about anything. I've always wanted to be able to play guitar. I've always wanted to be able to play and sing. When I started, worked up the nerve to you know, get a gig somewhere. I mean, I backed into this whole thing, Jody. I booked myself. My first gig, I booked myself. I booked the coffee house at school, and you know, I auditioned for myself, and then I gave myself a gig. I've just always sort of tried to figure out what I could do, you know, and I've just never felt like I was a good enough singer to be for somebody to hire as a singer. I'm not a good enough guitar player for somebody to say, hey, come play guitar in my band. I've always tried to look at, well, what can I do that would be of interest, and sort of making stuff up was kind of what I thought was my best chance, and you know, presenting my point of view, you know, that's what sort of drew me in that direction, thankfully, I get to do it.
John, was there a moment of epiphany for you where you thought, I want to write the songs? I know there's a guy that does this, a guy that does that, but I want to be the one who's got his name in parentheses on the record.
No, you know, I think I'm like Lyle. I picked up a guitar and I was just sort of compelled, you know, to start writing. I couldn't, like Lyle, I wasn't any hot, you know, my buddies were up in their rooms copping, Hendrix slicks, and I just couldn't play that way. So I just started playing some chords, and next thing you know, I was making up songs, I guess, because, you know, that's what I could do, I guess. And so, and I was compelled to sing and play somehow, you know. I wanted to do it. And, you know, I was a fat kid, so it was weird. I was very shy and really fat. So for me to get up in front of people was like, I had to be compelled, you know, because I wasn't. It's not like I cut some sort of a, you know, cool figure or anything like that. But I just wanted to play. I wanted to play and sing. So.
And Lyle, on your last record, you did, and you've done a double album of other people's songs,
yes.
But Natural Forces was a mixture of your songs and other people's songs.
Yes.
But John, you're not given to doing covers very often, are you?
You know, I've intermittently felt bad about that over the years because I love, there's so many songs that I love, but you know what? I write songs and I want to record them, so I just feel like, you know, and I make about one record a year, it seems like, so I just kind of get tied up doing my own stuff. I know it's selfish, but I'm a selfish guy.
And so many people have covered your songs, John, Bonnie Raitt and Roseanne Cash and Eric Clapton and B.B. King and Bob Dylan. And Lyle, I don't hear as many people. I'm really being serious here. I've heard the Holmes Brothers did a great rendition of your songs, but do you think your songs are a little too idiosyncratic for a lot of people to do them?
I don't know, Jody, but that's really true. My songs aren't obviously the sort of songs that some that a popular recording artist is going to hear and think. Well, that's gonna, you know, I joke with John that, you know, when somebody, I mean, because people have done my songs, but. And it's really true in John's case that people have taken John's songs and their careers have gone into a whole another gear. You know, John's songs have taken people's careers into the next level. I always tell John that, you know, when somebody says they're going to record one of my songs, I worry about their career. I worry that that's, you know, the obituary in Rolling Stone is going to say, and things were going so well until.
Well, I think the difference is that Lyle's sort of done the definitive version of his songs. One it could be argued, you know, and he's had success with his songs, whereas, you know, it could be argued that my own versions of my songs maybe are not the definitive versions, and certainly the success with those songs has been eclipsed by other artists, you know. So I think I think that's a big difference. I think Lyle has been the artist to have the success with his songs.
See how generous he is.
I really mean that. I think that's the big difference.
But a prouder.
He
moment.
Talks about how quirky he is, but I think he's it's not all that quirky.
A prouder moment than finding out somebody is going to record one of your songs that you won't have. Lou Rawls recorded "She's No Lady," and "Good Intentions." Willie Nelson recorded "If I Were the Man You Wanted." And farther down the line, Johnny Taylor did "She's No Lady."
Unbelievable.
And I tell you, every time I get to hear, you know, somebody else do one of my songs, I mean, it just makes you proud.
To get a Johnny Taylor cut, I would, you know.
I was very proud of that.
I'd be a happy man.
And Willie.
Willie
sang "Farther Down the Line," and pronounced it "Further Down the Line." I loved it.
The Holmes Brothers did an amazing version of, did they do "God Will"? I think it was, or if I had a boat, but
you know, I don't know, Jody. I haven't heard it.
Oh, on Alligator Records, beautiful.
Oh, wow. Cool.
Talking to Lyle Lovett and John Hiatt, who are playing the Paramount tonight, and Lyle Lovett's going to play us a song right now. I'm putting you on the spot, Lyle.
You know, John and I, we make a point not to discuss what we plan on playing in a night, and really the plan, we can't make a plan because it just wouldn't hold up because the, you know, we influence one another. You know, the whole show has to be sort of one set of music, and I always think about what my junior high basketball coach always told us before we go in the game. He'd say, "Remember, boys, if they're running the flat, if they're running the fast break, slow it down." But here's one, and our arrangements just sort of evolve spontaneously, and here's one that John has contributed to before.
In his hand it fell behind, as his arm it reached around. Ooh, and she looked at the window, and she watched the shade go down. It was a private conversation, no one heard her say. That man she left behind was 2,000 miles away. Singing, "Boy, pick up that fiddle, ooh, and play that steel guitar.
guitar. Go and find yourself a lady. Go and dance right where you are. Yeah. Yeah. Never stopped to wonder if she'd see him again. It was a private conversation. No one heard her say that man that she was looking for was only 20 streets away. Singing, boy, pick up that fiddle. Go and play that steel guitar. Go and find yourself a lady. Go and dance right where you are. Yeah. And the band just kept playing. When she came walking in, knowing he never stopped to wonder if he'd see her again. It was a private conversation, and no one heard him say that girl he left behind was 2,000 miles away. He just sang, boy, pick up that fiddle.
Lyle Lovett, Private Conversation, live on KUT 90.5 with an assist from John Hiatt. These gentlemen will be at the Paramount Theater tonight and tomorrow night. Okay, John, so Lyle just plays Private Conversation. We're on stage at the Paramount. What are you coming back with? I mean, I want to kind of...
But we're not, Jody.
I wanted to kind of see how it rolled, you know? What would
Well, I think like Lyle said, like his basketball coach said, maybe slow it down. That was pretty rocking, you know. No sense trying to top that.
But in fact, when John plays something really up and rocking, it gives me a chance to play a ballad. And so in that way, I mean, we really do have to sort of, and that's what makes the show fun too. Because it's just happening right then, and we have to be able to sort of, you know, be awake.
Yeah, we'll play back to back rockers. We've done that certainly, and
You do that.
Well, you do too. Lyle, come on, you rock. You rock.
I don't rock.
You rock. I see those horns come up.
I've never.
But I'll play another new one from the new record.
smoky room in a thin blue light. Her arms were pale as white, trying to outlast the night, howling at the moon. Living in the canyon then, hang down Hannah and whiskey gin, dirty jeans and mudslide hymns. That all began with soon. So adios to California, nothing to do but turn around. I always knew there's someone coming for you. Only way you'd leave this town. Pasadena in the rain, eating donuts and reading Twain. How much longer can my brain set itself on fire? You said that's it for me. Have a little faith, it might set you free. But your faith's no good, you see, for me and my desire. So adios to California. Nothing to do but turn around. I always thought there's someone coming for you. Only way you leave this town. Cigarettes from the package gone. You must have thought about it just that long. I never knew you were so strong. Guess I never will. So adios to California. Nothing to do but turn around. I always knew someone coming for you. Only way you'd leave this town.
John Hiatt with a new song called Adios to California. And we're live on KUT 90.5. Some wonderful details in that song. I love the two cigarettes, and it is the first song to mention donuts and Twain, I think, in one line there.
Well, let it be the last, Jody.
Lyle, that's off the books for you now. You cannot go there. But you're saying goodbye there, and we're in a historic building where we said goodbye to the what's called Studio 6A, five floors above us. And that's where Austin City Limits was taped for 36 years.
Yeah, yeah.
And I saw you there, John, at least a couple times.
Yeah, I played there a couple times. I understand you played the last one, Lyle. Somebody told me that. Little birdie told me that.
I tell you, it was a real, real honor to get to be there. You know, and it was just an honor to, you know, any time you get to do that show. But I tell you, and as great as that studio was and as much history as was there, what makes Austin City Limits Austin City Limits is it's the people.
Yeah.
And you know, it was Bill Arhos's vision. It's the way Terry Lacona has done it all these years with Jeff Peterson and Susan Caldwell and Vance Holmes and all the guys that work. So Billy Myers, who used to do sound, and David Huff, it's their spirit and their heart really that makes Austin City Limits what it is, and that will exist wherever they are.
Yeah, that's the thing, you know. It's always about the people. It's never about the building or or the brand or the label or whatever. You know, it's always about the folks.
But it was a really nice occasion to be there on the last taping and, you know, to see all those folks that had, and because some of the folks that worked on the show worked for the school and the state, you know, worked for the station, and some of them actually, you know, worked just for the show. So not everybody that worked on the show would go. So there was a real, I mean, it was really nice to see all that and to be a part of it.
And John's one or two of your performances there have been commercially released. And
yeah,
Lyle, you know, I was looking for video of you guys knowing I was going to do this. And neither of you, besides that show, have like a long form concert DVD at this point.
No, sir. We've managed to avoid success in that department.
I think the time has come.
Well, thanks, Jody.
But I did find some amazing clips. And I tell you, John, I got this new Levon Helm DVD at the Ryman.
Wow. Yeah.
And you come out at the very end. I think you sing The Wait with...
Yeah, just harmonies. I think I took a verse. But, you know, Lee is such a gracious, wonderful guy and such a great, great singer and musician. And yeah, he invited me out to join him, along with a bunch of other people in Nashville. And,
oh, cool. Which verse did you do?
Did you do Crazy Chester?
Crazy Chester.
Yeah. Oh, nice. Yeah. That's great.
The Crazy Chester verse. Yeah. And yeah, he's terrific. You know, we did some shows with him last summer. Toured around with him, did about a dozen dates. And he's such a sweetheart.
Boy.
Wonderful man.
I'm in awe just watching him on the screen.
Yeah.
Levon Helm.
Yeah, he's something.
And then, Lyle, I came across this Paul Simon tribute. And you did 50 Ways to Leave Your Lover. I think it was with the Jesse Dixon Singers. And it was almost like the song was written for Lyle, you know, that, and your delivery, I mean, gosh, I sure enjoyed it.
Oh, thank you very much. What an honor to get to sing that song. The you know, that was part of the Gershwin, the first Gershwin Prize, which is a kind of a new deal, just the last few years. They honor a songwriter, and Paul Simon was the first. The Library of Congress. It was a Library of Congress honor, and they did. They made a TV show out of it, and I got to sing that, and it was, you know, really good. The rehearsal, because Paul was there at the rehearsal, and we sang it the first time through. We sang it together. He said, "Would you like me to sing it with you for phrasing?" And he stood on the same mic with me, and we sang it together, and it was just one of those things you just will never ever forget.
Yeah.
Well, no one's more deserving of the Gershwin Prize than Mr. Paul Simon.
Yeah, amazing.
And no one more deserving to be named the official Texas State Musician for 2011 than Mr. Lyle Lovett. Congratulations.
No, thank you, Jody. Thank you. I tell you, that's, you know, the Texas Commission on the Arts does such a wonderful work for the arts, and to be part of that, and to be in the great tradition of on that list is really, really a nice thing. I mean, Sarah Hickman was but last year, and Billy Gibbons is next year, and to be in that company, and to get to, you know, spend a morning at the Capitol and get to go around. I mean, it was a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful experience.
Well, right here in the Capitol of Texas, we've got two shows with Lyle Lovett and John Hiatt at the wonderful Paramount Theater, and we've got one more song live on KUT from the official Texas State Musician for 2011. Who did recently perform at the Library of Congress himself, Mr. Lyle Lovett.
That's a lot of pressure, Jody. I played the song in honor of that first time I saw John Hiatt on stage at the Paramount Theater with Uncle Walt's band opening the show. This is a Walter Hiatt song that I recorded on the Step Inside This House album. And so play this for Warren Hood out there. Walter and Champ and David were always so great to me, and Warren is just such a tremendous talent. We've actually been playing Warren's CD before our shows.
Yeah, he's really
sounds
great.
Yeah, yeah, every night. I've enjoyed hearing him.
Looking at the stars, wondering where you are, lonely in love. Looking at the sky, start to wonder, my love, how long I'm gonna burn with the same old flame. I'm miss you all the time. Ain't unhappy, but I'm lonely in love. I know I didn't treat you right, scared you into flight, lonely in love. Never acted wise, couldn't organize love. But these longings return when I hear your name. I let you go and now I can't forget. Somehow I'm only in love. I'm young in the daylight with a pocket full of money. Ladies to the left and to the right. But when nighttime comes, I'm a star watcher, honey. I can't get along on light bulb light. So looking at the stars, wondering where you are, lonely in love. Looking at the sky, start to wonder, my love. How long I'm gonna burn with the same old flame? No, it don't make any sense, honey. Be convinced I'm lonely in love. Lonely, lonely. Yes, I'm lonely in love.
Lyle Lovett, bringing us full circle. Lyle first saw John Hiatt play at the Paramount some 30 years ago. Uncle Walt's band was on the bill, and that was a Walter Hiatt song called Lonely in Love. And 30 years later, they're together on stage tonight and tomorrow night at the Paramount Theater. Thanks for taking some time this afternoon to spend time with us.
My pleasure, Jody.
Jody, thanks for having us.
Yeah.
Great to see you.
Good to see you.
Look forward to seeing you at the Paramount. Lyle Lovett and John Hiatt live on KUT. And our thanks to Cliff Hargrove, our engineer today, and a big thank you to Jay Trachtenberg for letting us be a part of his show. And we're going to throw it back up to Jay on KUT 90.5.